Consider your praises as we continue, O God, to continue to have that joy that Jesus still brings and sings in our hearts. We pray that you breathe the breath of new life onto us soon. We pray, O God, that you open our hearts to all the wondrous gifts that you have for us to do, that you continue to prepare us to do during this season. We welcome, O God, the Spirit into our vision this glorious day. And pray that as the waves sing and as the seas roar and as the winds roar, that you bless our lives and testimonies to your redeeming love. We confess, O God, that we are too often one group for everything. We want proof that someone loves us. We want proof that we can trust others. We want proof that everything in life is going to go according to plan and to operate. And so it is easy for us, O God, when we come with that mindset, to point our fingers to those who are honest about their doubts and their fears. Forgive us, O Spirit, O God, for our arrogance and our pride. Forgive the many times, O God, when we think and act in ways which are harmful to your people. And run this sins from this your pastor. Heal our wounds, we pray. Find our spirits in the cause of your compassion. Help us to fully place our trust in you with our whole hearts, our minds, our spirits, and our souls. For we ask this in your most blessed and holy name, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. What's the praise will be this?
Integrity of those that we may trust, that we may love.
being told of this grace of God by people that he knows very well, people that he spends a lot of time with. All throughout Jesus' ministry, these men were together. They knew one another, they knew who was trustworthy, they knew who was untrustworthy. They knew who liked to exaggerate stories, and they knew who told it as was. And when you think about that, related to our own lives, we can think about our own friends and our own family. Every once in a while we have someone that's telling a very exaggerated story that you can't believe. And you have that one friend or family member that you can say to, and you can say, is everything that he's saying correct? And whatever they say, you're more likely to believe. We think of, when we think of those things, promises to humanity, because it's relatable for us. Everything that he would have gone through throughout Passion Week and that weekend, the arrest and the fear that comes with that, the flogging, the crucifixion itself that he was not witness to, but would have heard from the woman above, the hiding of the disciples as a result of it, the shame of running away from a person that he thought he'd given his life for. Thomas and the other disciples were in grief. They were also in shame. But Thomas in this passage lives there because he has not seen the risen Lord as yet. We think about Thomas' doubt, and we think about everything that we know in our recorded history. And in very recent recorded history, there are instances and examples recorded of persons waking up, having been pronounced dead. By physicians. And there are proper explanations and instances of that. There was one in 2011, one in 2014, and one in 2018 in Spain, Poland, and South Africa. In the 2018 incident, the family was actually brought to the mortuary and saw the markings on their loved one's body where the autopsy would have been done. There's a finality in that for knowing that this body is going to be cut open, this body is going to be pierced. There's a finality in knowing this person that is properly dead. And so being told otherwise, getting the call just a couple hours later, no, this person that you saw lying there, ready to be cut open, is now alive. It causes doubt in our minds. The doctor, the 2014 incident in Spain said, I was sure that she was dead. I'm stunned, I don't know what happened. Her heart had stopped beating. She was no longer breathing. No matter who we are, whether we're experienced physicians or lay physicians, nothing prepares us for the unexpected. Because that's what it is, it's unexpected. And so we can easily hear Thomas saying something similar to what that doctor said. They pierced his side. I hear it from the woman. They put his body, his lifeless body, in the tomb. I don't understand what you're telling me, what is happening. I will not believe it. And here the famous words uttered from him, unless I see the mark of nails on his hand, I put my finger in there. At his side, I shall not breathe. I'm not one of those that blame Thomas for what he called his family. Because, as you would have gathered so far, I think it's a very human response to a very divine thing that is happening. None of the events that we've read about over the past 2 weeks are normal. They're not. We normalize them in our church because we read them. Continue to hear about them, but they are not the normal. They are divine things that are happening, miraculous things. Thomas essentially was God in his heart from the disappointment that would come with being hopeful. He didn't want to hope that what they were saying was true. Because if what they were saying was wrong, he would feel even more defeated. And Jesus uses this experience that all of the disciples are going through this shame and guilt and loss when he's risen. Jesus uses this and this time of Easter time that we think of to prepare the disciples before his ascension for what is to come in their lives that we'll read about in the book of Acts. For them receiving the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, for the commissioning of that and sending that into the world, for them being ridiculed by the Jewish people about the message of the risen Savior. Preparation, because many of them still had their doubts and their fears as well. And if you have your doubts and fears about your faith, about the center of your faith and where it comes from, you're not convicted enough then to convince other Christians that you can believe what you believe. And that's why being prepared is a good thing. We do it in various other aspects of our own lives, for interviews and for meetings, prepare for job meetings, shape interviews as a being. The passage and the example of Thomas reminds us that we are to re-examine our faith, especially after coming out of the high of Easter time. Because it's not so much about the faith of Thomas, but about Thomas preparing himself for what it might be. If the disciples, if what they were saying was true, then surely Jesus would reveal himself again. And so Thomas didn't want to live in that pool, that he may not see the risen Lord as they saw it, so he would never believe. Thomas didn't want to live in that pool when the reality of the darkness that he'd been through for the past week was glaring and present. They would go on to continue to face this darkness and to face these obstacles. And we see that in the passage that was read from the book of Acts as well. We meet the disciples being questioned by the court, by the high priest in the court, saying, "We gave you strict orders not to preach and teach about this man, not to have these teachings, and yet came a fellowship to our women." And so the disciples, in their rebuttal, give their testimony, and it enrages everyone once more. And out of that, a very unlikely hero emerges. His name was Gamaliel, and he was a first century Jewish rabbi and a leader of an individual Jewish Sanhedrin. And he seems to have been very prepared for what was about to happen. Because he says, "Fellow Israelites, consider carefully what you propose to do to these men. For some time ago, Thaddeus rose up, claiming to be somebody, and a number of men, about 400, joined him. But he was killed. And all who followed him were dispersed and disappeared. After him, Judas the Galilean rose at the time of the census and got people to follow him as well. He also perished. And all who followed him were scattered." He presents a sign of peace. "So in the present case, I tell you, keep away from these men and let them alone. Because if this plan or this undertaking is of human origin, it will fail just like a vessel. But if it is God, you will not be able to overthrow them. In that case, you may even come fighting against God." Gabriel has a way of ways. He uses reason, he uses wit, he uses a bit of psychology as well, to avert the attention from the disciples' crimes, so-called crimes, to instead telling people that they could instead be proven right, yes, but not through the court, but through the actions of God. Don't let the court deal with this. We've seen how it's been done before. Let God deal with it. He takes it out of their hands in a very tactical way. He convinces them. And so in God's sovereign plan, this Jewish rabbi preserved the lives of the apostles in the early church. And we may think that's the end of the story. We we think that that's how Gamaliel seals the apostle and the early church. But that's not all this man does. You see, one of this rabbi's most studious students was none other than Saul of Tarsus. Saul of Tarsus, who had been in that courtroom with his rabbi, hearing his rabbi on the defense against, a defense for the apostles. Saul, who would go on to persecute these apostles in various ways, even though his rabbi has convinced them to let them live. For the person who would be known as the greatest missionary, preparation. It was under the tutelage of Rabbi Gamaliel that Paul developed that excellent knowledge of the Hebrew scriptures that we would see in his writings. It would be Paul's educational and professional credentials from under this rabbi that allowed him to preach in the synagogues where he went. It was his grasp of Old Testament theology and history and law that would aid in his influencing others in his presentation of who Jesus was as the one who had fulfilled the law that he knew so well. God's divine plan was in motion through the preparation of his disciples long before they knew it, and even while they were persecuted. Planning to persecute the apostles. Gamaliel lived in his own rather lenient view of the Old Testament law. In contrast to his contemporaries, Gamaliel, with his tactful words of wisdom, saving the early church leaders from death, Gamaliel lived God's divine plan, preserving and preparing the lives of the apostles, and especially Paul, in the early church. And helping to equip the greatest Christian missionary preparation. That is what we see in this passage. We think about how we prepare ourselves for service to the world. We think about how we help to prepare others within our congregation, within our lives, our whole public places, in order to continue to live in the suppress in the world. We think about the mandates that then come to the apostles and disciples afterwards to go out into the world. How are we prepared as a congregation, as individuals, to profess our faith if need be? Are we prepared? How do we continue to? There are many ways within the region, within this church itself, that we can do so. And so, we say to that. And we say, this is not devotions, only not devotions. We continue to prepare ourselves for the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And we thank God for the unlikely allies that prepare us through doubt and through faith for the will of this kingdom here on earth. In the name of the Father, bless us and keep us, that you will make your face to shine upon us and be gracious to us, that you will lift up your countenance upon us and grant us your grace, your peace, and your guidance.